Hey, everybody. It is time once again for Comic Art Convo. I am your friend Aaron, Second Chance Lopresti. That, of course, is referring to my Second Chance, Second Print campaign of Wraith of God, number one, which is on Indiegogo right now. And there's a link in the description of this video if you want to go check that out at some point during the day. Also, for my campaign, Wraith of God Bloodhunters is also there. But today, we're talking about our favorite animated films, and I can't do that by myself, so let me bring in James, also known as Sequential Treasure. Hey, James. Is that I think I'm turning Japanese? This is why you pay good money for this show, folks, to get entertainment like this. You can't find anyplace else.
There you go, folks. A little animated intro for everybody.
Wow. I'm going to assume that was from the Transformers soundtrack or something.
Yes. Dare to be Stupid by Weird Al Yankovic.
Dare to be Stupid by Weird Al Yankovic. There you have it, folks. Run out to your, I guess you don't, there's no record stores anymore to go find that. I guess you just download it. Oh my goodness. Let's take a look, quick look, see who's here. Then we'll get rolling. Tarks9 is here all the way from Canada. Leg Kick is here because of course Leg Kick is almost always here. Dan, the Pizza Man Genovese is here. H is for Heretic. Geek Avenger.
Bill, yes, he even called on early to what I was doing. He's daring to be stupid. Yes.
Bill Maxwell, Anti-Entity is here. Kevin Thomas. Fritzy Schnitzel is here. Paul Brillart, of course, is here, our resident engineer. Marcus Killigrew, thanks for joining us, guys. Let's see who else. Ellie Munoz, Jefferson Roswell. And Heat Miser is here, but where's Cold Miser? Heat Miser is here. Steep Sheeple Hunter, Mr. Solomon, Dumbest Name is here, and he comes equipped with double question marks. And Cloth the Raven, Lewis Bright Raven is here. Lloyd Delagarde, hey, there's Lloyd Delagarde. Lloyd Delagarde, also known as the Collector, just bought a humongous collection, and he's sharing bits and pieces of it, comic book collection, of course, on Twitter, and getting me all jealous. But I've never had that experience where I've gone someplace and somebody said, hey, look at my 40 boxes of comics. Would you like to buy these for $5,000? Never had that happen to me. Never. I keep waiting for that moment where...
Well, I had the moment where I said, hey, I want to sell my 60 long boxes of comics. How about some money? And they're like, all right, here's $5,000.
Yeah, it went the other way. It was like,
that's went the other way.
I actually did go before we moved to Florida to go to CrossGen. There was an estate sale and they actually said in the thing comics. And I was like, holy crap. So we had to drive a ways, but we went out to this place and they had some stuff. I got a, they had a Luke K, they had a Hero for Hire number one. And probably VF condition. So I was like, that was worth the drive alone. And this is before it really blew up, but it was still on the move at that point. And then what did I get? The first black costume, Spidey. And I guess it isn't officially, but it's the origin of the black costume is Marvel Secret Wars number 8. They had that. And then like a couple of X-Men issues and nothing too huge, but it was at least, you know, I came back with like 10 comic books. So I felt like, you know, it was worth the trip. But that's the only time in my life I ever went to a yard sale, estate sale, anything, and found some cheap comics. So.
Well, speaking of comics,
mm-hmm.
I've got in my first graded goodness of the year.
Uh-oh. All right. What did you get?
I know, Aaron, you're going to want to see this one, Aaron. You're going to like this one.
All right. I'm going to blow you up so I can... We get okay. Here you go.
Well, he needs to make me big on the screen, folks. He's not talking about a cannonball.
No. Oh,
Tomb of Dracula number 52.
Who is the demon? What does that say? Who is the Dracula demon? Dracula. Fears. Now, is there something special about this issue?
This is another one I got from that kid, the one before I found the spinner.
Yeah, that's in right.
9-4, and here's the thing too: is look at that corner box. It doesn't have a slash mark through it. You know how hard that is to find on these books of this era, where the barcode is not slashed through.
Really,
that's hard to do.
I didn't know that. This is okay. So, what year was that? What year is that?
Cover date's January of 77, but it probably came out like September of 76. That's when it was on the newsstands.
Now, when you say slash through the barcode, you're talking about like the 7-Eleven owner would like put a
like a marker from this corner diagonal down, just like right through it. Ugh. I've seen many like that over the years.
Interesting. Interesting.
And if that isn't enough for you guys,
it's never enough.
Some extra special and different. My order from Discount Comic Book Service came in a couple days ago, and I decided why open it now when I can wait until the show and show all of you, and you can see some new stuff.
I want to see it. I want to see what.
Now, of course, got the trusty box cutter here. Now, remember, kids, do not try this at home without your parents' express permission and supervision. I am a professional, so.
And it's like, don't cut your fingers, and don't cut towards yourself, and don't slash wildly, and don't run with scissors. For Peasy says he's backer number 16 from Second Chance Campaign. Thank you very much, man. I appreciate that.
Okay, first up.
Oh, what?
From Warrant Publishing, which is basically the new Warren.
Oh, so this is brand new.
Yes.
Terrifying Tales. Now, is this reprint material or is this all new stories of a horrific?
This is the annual for 2024. It reprints some of the stuff from previous issues, and I think it has like maybe one new story in it.
But it's not like old creepy and eerie.
No. But it's done in the same exact style as the old creepy and stuff. It's because, like I said, the company is called Warrant Publishing.
Not
to play on Warren. Warren. They're doing the horror stuff. Exactly. That's their version of Vampirella, the vampirist Carmilla. And the only other thing in here that came in, Ronin 2, number 2.
Now, is it, this Miller. Is, this is Miller's line that Dan DiDio is in charge of. How about that? Now, have you been reading this stuff?
I read the first one. It was a bit confusing, so... Mm. But the art is beautiful. Philip Tan is doing beautiful, beautiful work.
Yeah, he's good. Custom God says, hey, Aaron, I saw you at the comic show today. I'm the guy who waved and said hi when you were coming down the stairs. Hey, thanks for dropping in, and thanks for saying hey at the show. We were at it's called the Frankenstein Comic Book Swap Meet, and it's it's not a con as much as it is a flea market sort of environment, but it's like, it's all comic book and a comic book related stuff. And it was actually pretty good today. I got a couple of books. I guess I should show them off the for my spinner rack. I couldn't find anything high grade that I was really enamored with, but I did pick up, where are they? This guy had some old FFs for like, like $8, right? And nice. I was like, And I mean, they're not in great shape, but for $8, let me go bigger here. So this is Fantasy Four number 84.
That is my favorite Kirby Doctor Doom story, is that storyline from 84 through 87. I love that storyline. That's a great story.
Yeah, there's a lot of good stuff in these old FFs. And I was just like, dude, you saw that? It's probably in VG condition, maybe.
It might be fine minus. It might be a fine minus.
It's not great, but I mean, for eight or, and this one for $10? Come on, man. Kidding me? So yeah, I grabbed these and I made sure they weren't falling apart, and they're going, they're in the old spinner rack. So that's what I did today. And of course I saw Custom God there. So he was masked up. So I did recognize his eyes and his wild hair. And that's how I knew. I said, I know that guy. So anyway, that's what Josh, my son, and I went and did that earlier today. Got some food.
Did he get anything any good while he was there?
No, he's he only buys like high grade. I mean, he's as bad or worse than I am, but he doesn't have a spinner rack like I do. So I can like, now I can get a couple of crappy books that are, I mean, crap books in crappy condition and just, you know, throw them in the old spinner rack. So that's where those guys are.
There's Richie Dupe with the obvious joke.
Richie, I buy that for $10. I'd buy that for $10. Yeah, so I spent $18. You know, what are you going to do? But this guy had a really nice Werewolf by Night number 3, and I almost bought it, but it had a real light stain on the back cover. And I was that makes me nervous because I just don't know what that does to the grade, you know? And even though he had it for $50, which, you know, if it was a near mint book, that's a steal at $50. But I wasn't really sure. I didn't know how to grade it with that kind of this very light stain on the back, almost not noticeable, but it was there. And my son's like, don't get it. The stain. All right. So I didn't get it, and they had an Iron Fist number 8 that has the classic burn cover, you know, with the fist coming at you.
Oh yeah.
And, but it wasn't quite in the shape I wanted to get it in. So I passed on that and ended up just getting the 2 FFs to put in the spinner rack. So I guess I'm a comic book snob, but there you go.
Well, your son sounds like more of a serious snob than you, though.
Well, he's way snobbier, and his eyes are better than mine. So he catches stuff that I don't even see. Like I'll grab a near mint book or what I think is near mint book. And I go, look at this. And he's like, dude, look, there's that. And I'm like, oh, I got my wrong glasses on apparently. So that's, I bring him now when I buy anything. So make sure that he checks it out first just in case I miss something. Cause I go in there and I want to buy, you know, James, I go in there.
Well, Lloyd Delagarty has your answer here about your fears.
Yes, it does. But how much though? That's what I didn't know. It was like, cause it almost looked like light, like maybe a sun shadow, you know, or something on the back of it. It was very light and it looked like it had kind of a straight edge to it. But my son said, no, this is definitely a stain. There's no edge to it. So I went, okay. So that's made me back off. But yes, Lloyd would know. Lloyd knows things about comics because he's a major collector and dealer up north, a Canadian friend of ours. So there you go. All right, no, folks.
Sorry, this is the fascist dictatorship of Canada.
That's
right. I feel bad for you, Lloyd. Sorry to hear that. But before we get to animated films, there is one other film we need to discuss. Uh-uh. Night of the Creeps.
I may never forgive you for this. I watched that. That is one of the worst films I've ever seen in my
life. Are you kidding me? That movie is hilarious. It is awesome.
God, it's so bad.
Tom Atkins is awesome in that film.
Oh, I was like, I'll never get this time back in my life. I just spent watching this movie. I would say it was one of the worst films I've ever seen in my life.
Wow. That is cold-blooded. Oh my God.
Oh, but thank you for sending it to me and making me watch it. Oh, got a little bit of there was like a little bit of nudity in there just to kind of get the keep your attention, but that was about it, you know. And
oh, come on, some of the dialogue is hilarious, cheese.
Well, yeah, I mean, I don't know. There's funny bad and bad bad, and for me, this was more along that line of bad bad. Oh, yeah, it was so funny bad, though, because it was so 80s, you know what I mean, and it was so. It was like, that was when I was, you know, in my 20s during the 80s. And it's just such a quintessential, low budget, cheap, bad 80s film. And so I did, I did get a little bit of a laugh at it here and there. Man, that was not good.
Tom Atkins with some of his deliveries, you know, thrill me. You know, just the way he delivers those lines.
Yeah, he was.
I got good news and bad news, girl. The good news is your dates are here. What's the bad news? Yeah. They're dead.
Who? What's the guy that played the detective? What's his name again?
Tom Atkins.
Yeah, he was in. He was in Lethal Weapon. He was the dad in Lethal Weapon that got shot by the helicopter.
He was also in Halloween 3, Season of the Witch.
No, see, now that's another movie I have not seen, and you will not trick me into watching. Have you seen Children of the Corn?
Yes.
Is it any good?
It's okay. It's not among my favorite horrors. I mean, I've seen a lot worse, trust me, but
well, Night of the Creeps.
That's not among the worst, though. That's funny. That's hilarious.
Well, I suppose it is, and just, you know, but I don't know. I mean,
you got horror, you got sci-fi, and you got comedy all rolled into one, and along with a little touch of
noir. You've got bad horror, cheap sci-fi, and unintentional comedy.
And it's a great brew. It's hilarious.
Okay. All right.
Any other person I've ever shown this film to, they're all laughing. They all like, dude, that was hilarious.
Oh, I was like, I can't take this. This is so bad. Maybe I was just in one of those moods. I don't know.
Anyway. I can't see how you could bag on Night of the Creeps. That's a hilarious film.
Oh gosh. I don't know. The acting and the dialogue was so bad. I was just struggling. All right. But enough of that. Let's get to the good stuff, James. We're here to talk about our favorite animated films today. And as always, we're going to start you off and then I will follow. So, you're starting off. This is pretty big. I mean, this is like Comic Geeks, animated dream movie.
I figured one of us would have to do this one.
There it is. It's heavy metal.
How can we not have heavy metal?
Let me get the super chat real quick. Geek Avenger for $5. Thanks, Geek. Appreciate it. Children of the Corn is not as scary as the real life SJW's Children of the Soy. Oh, my goodness. Okay. So tell me why you love this movie.
Because it's like kind of all over the place. And yet they try to stitch it all together into a cohesive whole. And it's just like, you know, like, pure imagination run wild for me. I love it for that reason alone. And, you know, we got great voice work from guys like Don Franks, John Candy, John Vernon, Eugene Levy, Richard Romanus from 1981. I mean, this is great stuff. You know, it's action and it's drama and it's sex and death and horror. And it's like all wrapped up together, all in a big ball. And I just love that. And I did some research on all this. And for example, the sequence of the exploding mansion at the movie's end was originally to be rotoscoped, but because they moved the release date of the film up, they didn't have time to do it. And so that remains the only non-animated sequence in the movie.
Interesting.
Because they didn't have time for that. Yes. Another bit of info here for you guys. The Tarnished storyline was by, of course, the acclaimed artist Mobius. And he was concerned about the environment, which is why the background had a great deal of randomly placed water pipes everywhere in the background scapes of that story.
Which one was Mobius's?
Tarna, the one right here on the cover, right here on the
Bad Barbarian. That was based on a Mobius story in heavy metal.
Yes.
Oh my gosh!
Yes, that was illustrated by the acclaimed artist Mobius.
I did not know that. Of course, I know that Wrightson, they use the Wrightson story, the Captain Stern.
Captain Stern, yes.
In that. I think they would have been better off not trying to connect the vignettes and just like have it kind of like an anthology sci-fi movie. Because I thought that was pretty, that sort of connective thread was a little weak. But I liked each individual story in and of itself, though. You know? So, I mean, I liked it. And it is
a case where, like, you've heard the expression, the whole is better than the sum of the parts. Well, this is kind of the first kind of the sum of the parts is better than the whole sometimes.
Right. Yeah.
Another bit of info for you guys here I got is on the Harry Cannon story. The New York Times he's holding in this one scene is dated July 3rd of 2031, which just happens to be Tom Cruise's 69th birthday. Why they chose him, I don't know, but they did. Let's see. The Canadian movie soundtrack for this, from the Canadian soundtrack, doesn't have any Canadian artists on the soundtrack, which is hilarious. Just more more fascism from this fascist dictatorship of Canada right there.
I really felt like this was sort of the quintessential 70s animated film, don't you think?
Well, it came out in 81, but yeah, I'm sure there was one in the 70s.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's all
Composer Elmer Bernstein, this is his first score for an animated film.
Really?
Yes.
Now, wait a minute. Didn't he do Animal House?
Yeah, but this is his first animated film.
Oh, okay. I got you.
This is the very first. And last bit I got here is in the Tarna sequence, the band in the bar is playing the song Through Being Cool by Devo, but yet that song was not included on the soundtrack of the movie.
That's outrageous.
Exactly.
Now,
don't play music in movies and TV if you don't plan on putting it on soundtracks.
Well, I guess maybe they just didn't want to pay, but I mean, how expensive could a Devo song been? I don't know. Ivan Reitman produced that. I had no idea until I just saw that on the movie poster that Ivan Reitman produced this movie. Wow.
Ellie Minogue has it here. You know, South Park did a spoof story where they shown their love for heavy metal in that episode.
Yes. Geek Avenger says, Aaron, did you want it to be like Grindhouse or an animated features? I don't know. I mean, I've seen anthology films before, like horror films and stuff like that, that don't necessarily have a connective tissue to them. And they're, you know, I just take each story in and of itself. Because I felt it was a little, I don't know, that connective thread just didn't, I don't know if it didn't really make a lot of sense to me. But you do have another picture here from the movie that I must share.
Yeah, we all love the movie and we love the vignettes, but this is the one that, of course, everyone loves best.
Everybody loves the booty.
Tarna. Yes.
Yeah.
You can never have enough Tarna booty. That's just how that goes.
Of course, I'm intrigued now.
Of all the vignettes, which one was your favorite, your personal favorite?
Well, when I went and saw it, I went and saw it because of the Wrightson thing. I wanted to see how that came to life. So, but I have to admit that John Candy as Den was hilarious. So maybe I would say Den might have been my favorite because I thought it was the funniest with John.
Favorite, the B-17 sequence.
Okay, wait a minute. Let's go over this real quick. There was the taxi driver at the beginning,
that's
one, right?
Cannon. Yeah.
Then it went into Captain Stern, I think, right?
And no, then from I think it was Den was next, and then Captain Stern.
Then Captain Stern, and then we had one other one, and then this one, right? What's the one I'm forgetting?
Yeah, the one you're forgetting is probably the B-17 bomber sequence.
Yeah, I can't remember what that was about. I'm blanking on that.
There was a bombing mission, and the plane gets shot up, and most of the guys on the plane die, and the orb that's the evil lodges itself inside of the plane, and it brings all the dead guys back to life, and the pilot has to bail out, and he lands on an island of like a plane graveyard. And then there, all the dead start coming up there, and he's like at the end, he's surrounded by the dead.
God, that sounds like why am I blanking? I'm gonna have to go back and watch this movie. I remember every sequence except that one for some reason. That's weird. I suppose if I saw it, it would all just come rushing back. And I haven't seen this movie in a long time. In fact, it was on. It might have been Turner Classics or one of those. It was on like they do like an underground thing every once in a while where they show like 70s movies or weird stuff.
Oh wait, we did forget one. Custom God came in. He got us the one we forgot. The one with the hot chick and the horny robot.
And space cocaine. Oh God, yes. I vaguely remember that one too.
The aliens who are flying the ship, they're all doing space cocaine while she's on there with a horny robot.
Yeah, I vaguely remember that one. See, the thing is, this came on, like I said, on TCM or something, but must have been really late at night because I only watched like the opening sequence with the taxi driver guy, and then I crashed and went to bed. So I didn't see the other ones. And the only other time I've seen this movie was when it came out in theaters back in 81. So it's been, 40 years since I've seen it, all of it, all the way through. So that may be why some of that is not sticking in my brain. But
I'll tell you folks this. I recently, just the other night, I saw one of the picks that I have on my lists here. So I've seen one of them very recently. So we'll get into that in a bit here, but let's move on to our next one.
All right. Well, I do have to show this. Talking about booty, right? So there's a little booty to go with the booty. It's a piece I just finished last night.
It's a booty sandwich.
That's right. It's a booty sandwich. Or someone said two Volvos trying to pass each other on the highway is what that looks like when she walks. So anyway,
now, okay. Heavy metal is an all-time classic. This one we're about to see is what I call modern classic.
I love this movie. This is a funny flick right there.
Wallace and Gromit, The Curse of the Were-Rabbit. I love Nick Park and Aardman Studios. I love their stuff. You know, I've loved these guys ever since back in, I think it was in 1999 or 2000 when I was working at a video store. And the manager introduced me to Wallace and Gromit in the shorts with like the close shave Wallace and Gromit, the wrong trousers.
Mm-hmm.
And I have loved them ever since. And so when I heard they're doing a full length feature, I'm like, oh, I've got to go see the movie. I can't not see the movie.
Yeah, these are so funny. Auntie Entity says, hi, does anyone see me? I guess not. We see you, Auntie Entity. We know you're there. I love this. The Aardman, those guys, everything they do, I love. It's hilarious. But this movie is next level.
Well, I mean, you know, it's very British in its humor.
Yeah, exactly. But it's good.
Very British in its humor.
Yeah.
You got some of the voice work here. You got Peter Salas, who is the voice of Wallace. And then this, you got Helen Bonham Carter and Ralph Fiennes also provide some voices in this as well.
Yeah. Helen Bonham Carter was that rich.
Lady Toddington.
Yeah.
And Ralph Fiennes was the hunter character.
Yes. Oh, that's right. Yeah. Yes. Beware the moon.
There's just so many. There's so many little things in the film. Like there's one scene when Toddington, when she's showing Wallace all her vast, you know, greenhouse garden, and she comes out holding two watermelons right here, and it's like, come on, we know what you're saying.
Oh my gosh, that's so funny.
The Brits and their those limeys in their humor. But no,
my kids, when they were little, didn't like this movie. It scared them. And now, of course, they have an appreciation, a great appreciation for it. But when they were little, they didn't. When he turned into that giant rabbit.
That's what I love about the humor in it, though, is like humor like that, it goes right over a kid's head. But us adults were going. But yes, the movie took 5 years to make. They started working on it shortly after the release of Chicken Run in 2000. They started working on this one.
Which I also like quite a bit.
And let's see. DreamWorks wanted to replace Peter Salas as the voice of Wallace. But Park, they wanted to replace him with a more well-known American actor. Somebody who was well-known in America, because this is an American release. But Nick Parks and his studio stood fast and said, no, he has to be Wallace because he is always Wallace. He has always been Wallace. He will always be Wallace. And instead, what he did is he bent for the studios, and that's how they got Ralph Fiennes and Helen Bonham Carter as roles in the movie.
Mm.
That was their concession to the studios to keep Peter Salas as Wallace, which, I mean, why would you do that? That makes no sense.
Well,
why would you make it
movie executives for you?
Yeah, exactly. It's like, you know, you watch all the shorts, you're like, oh, this is awesome. I love that guy. And then you see him in the big movie, and it's like, that doesn't sound like him.
Right. It's like, why is that guy's voice different, you know?
But here's one I found out. Here's a little nugget I found out that I think you're going to enjoy personally, Aaron. The church scene with all the villagers, when they get together to talk about, you know, the were-rabbit and everything, was meant to homage the scene in Jaws where the people of Amity are discussing how to deal with the shark.
Oh, really? Now I'm going to go back and look at that scene. I have this on DVD.
And again, here it is again, the British humor. I love this. After Wallace has been returned to normal, he's like, of course, nude because he ripped out of his clothes when he turned into the giant were-rabbit. And so he has to throw on something. He throws in a box that says cheese because he loves cheese. But look at the sign above it. May contain nuts right over his junk. And it's, I think Gromit's expression says it all. this is the genius of their humor. They can do this, and you and I are laughing as adults, but a kid isn't going to catch this.
Yep.
Let's see what else we got here. Actually, and here's the thing too, is even though this is claymation, the film has a considerable amount of CGI in it. From Drifting Bob to the bunny rabbits and the bunny vac and all this stuff, there are over 700 shots that contain some kind of digital effects work. So even in this, you know, you can't escape CGI.
Well, of course, you saw the movie they did that was the Hugh Jackman movie where he's the mouse and he gets flushed away, where he gets flushed down the toilet. That was all CGI, but it was done in this style, right? So it's like, but I much prefer the traditional claymation than
another reference here for you. The climax sequence at Tottenham Hall, where the were-rabbit, you know, grabs Lady Toddington and climbs up and gets to the top of the building,
mm-hmm.
is a homage spoof to King Kong, because this movie came out the same year that the Peter Jackson remake of King Kong came out. And this was their little nod to that.
Oh my gosh.
You know, even to the point where like he's clutching a flagpole at the top of the building, just in case you weren't sure enough. Is this homaging King Kong? Yes, it is.
Well, I figured it was, but I didn't make the connection with the Peter Jackson film, because obviously that, you know, King Kong, that moment in King Kong where he goes up, you know, with Fay Wray or whoever up to the top of the Empire State Building or wherever it ends up being, depending on which film you're talking about, which version. It's like, iconic.
No, Kevin, I don't think Wallace was packing serious heat, because if he was, that would melt the cheese and he probably wouldn't like that too much.
That's right. Yeah.
But the last bit I got here, and this is sad news, is shortly after the film was released, it was a huge success for Aardman Studios. But shortly after that happened, the warehouse for Aardman Studios burned down and took all that stuff with it.
That's what Folsom says right here. So sad when Aardman burned down and they lost all that work.
It was shortly after the film was released. It came out. It was a big success initially, and then tragedy happens. But Nick Park was quoted as saying, even though it's a precious and nostalgic collection and valuable to the company, in light of other tragedies, today isn't a big deal. So I guess that British stiff upper lip type thing was going on there.
So basically all the stuff they'd done up to that point that they'd been storing in there was lost. Everything
it's
was
all gone. That's probably why you haven't seen any new Wallace and Gromit stuff since this.
Oh, geez. I for some reason I didn't know about that. I didn't know that there was they lost a lot of stuff in a fire. That's too bad. What a bummer, man. I hate it when really cool art stuff gets destroyed. Okay. On that sour note. Okay, now this, you're gonna
now we get to one that's a little more esoteric for folks. Yeah, there's some in the chat who know this movie and some who don't.
I do not know this film, so you're gonna have to fill me in on this.
Baby's Kids. I love Baby's Kids. This is based off of a comedy routine from a comedian named Robin Harris. He did a whole skit about Baby's Kids and his comedy routine and the stand-up he does.
Okay.
And they made a movie about it. And one of the executive directors of the film, Reginald Hudlin, from Milestone.
Oh, okay. Really?
Yes. He was one of the executive producers of this film. And basically it's a story of a guy who takes a woman out who has a son, and she's babysitting Bebe's kids. And so he has to take all of them out. And Bebe's kids are, well, let's just say that if we're going to use the correct terminology, they are hood rats. Let's put it that way. And that they behave that way. And so he takes them to like an amusement park, and it's just total chaos when these kids are let loose.
And is this a TV movie or is this a theatrical
movie? No, this was an actual feature film in 1992. It was released on screens in 92. And we got lots of great black actors doing voice work. You got the great Tone Loke.
Oh, really?
He does one of the voices there. He does Pee-wee, the little baby right there. You got Nell Carter from Give Me a Break is on there. Yeah. You got John Witherspoon. You got George Wallace. And of course, Faison Love, who does the voice of Robin Harris's character there, because you know, this movie made its theatrical debut in 92, and that was 2 years after Robin Harris himself had passed away.
Hmm.
So
well, you're just filling us with tragedy today, aren't you, James?
No, but there is there, but it's funny you did bring up the thing about a TV movie, because it says here, according to the director Bruce W. Smith, Baby's Kids was originally intended to be a TV movie. After the film production had wrapped, the head of the studio pushed it to be a feature film instead.
I wonder how it did at the box office.
Yeah, I think it's more of a cult classic, I think, than a major hit.
Is this Paramount did this? It looks like.
Yes, Paramount.
I wonder. You wonder on this. How is the animation in it?
I liked it. I liked it. It had a little bit of a Ralph Bakshi look to it, but it wasn't. Mm. And I like that about it. It's a little more urban, a little more street, and I like that touch. Funny enough, this is the first ever fully animated film to be rated PG-13.
Really? I was curious. I was looking for the rating on the poster.
You know, Cool World also came out in 92 ahead of this, but it was also, that was live action and animation, whereas this is just pure fully animated. So this is fully animated film that was PG-13.
Cool World. Is that the one that Brad Pitt was in?
Brad Pitt and, what's her name? I'm blanking on her, the blonde.
Well, I'm lucky I remembered Brad Pitt that was in it.
But yes, they both came out the same year. They were both PG-13, but this is the first fully animated film that was PG-13. And, you know, we can get a shot of some animation right here. Show a little still from our...
Yeah, I'll bring that up. There we go.
And there they are, Bebe's kids. They don't die, they multiply. That's their catchphrase. We're Bebe's kids. We don't die, we multiply. But this was originally conceived as a live action film, but then after Robin Harris died during pre-production of a live action version, they moved it off and changed it to animated. That's why this was an animated movie, is because he died.
Really?
Kim Basinger, that's it. She's the one.
Yeah, in
Hollywood. As in, like, would what? What wouldn't she?
Would what? What wouldn't she? I have never seen Cool World other than a few scenes. I've never actually sat down and watched the whole thing.
I saw it once quite a while ago. It wasn't all that. I mean, the animation was nice and stuff, but the story just didn't grab me.
Marcus Killigrew says that this became the Proud Family. And that it kind of has that look to it. I thought it was cool.
I hope he doesn't mean the modern one they have running now. Oh, my God, no.
No, like the other one before that, which was actually pretty good.
Yeah, the original maybe. Okay, not the new one.
Yeah, the non-woke one.
Yeah, like I said, and this is all based off of Robin Harris's, like, stand-up comedy where he talks about Baby's Kids, but they had to make some changes in the film, because in his stand-up, he talked about taking Baby's Kids to Disneyland, and of course, you know how Disney is about their rights, and so they had to change it in the movie from Disneyland, that the theme park is called Fun World. And, wow. You know, again, it's just got lots of great... And another great actor who had a small role in this, the great Rich Little.
Rich Little was
put
in this?
A voice here, doing a, he was the voice of a robot that would look like Richard Nixon. And he did Richard Nixon voice.
Oh my gosh, that's good. Oh, I have so, to yeah, say, man, I you're saying this is on YouTube,
but you know, yeah, but Baby's Kids, it's a hilarious film. You know, it, you know, I grew up in like the Northeast, you know, outside of Philly, so I mean, like the whole black culture thing, I get a lot of the jokes in there. And there's this one great scene when Robin Harris's character is in a bathroom arguing with his ex-wife, and they start throwing snaps out at each other about their mama, the yo mama jokes. You know, your mama's so fat, she on both sides of the family. your mama's so dumb that she said it was chilly outside. She ran and got a bowl. And they're just like throwing snaps out. I'm just cracking up. It's just great stuff. And you gotta listen when Fajon Love does Harris's voice, because like he'll say things and it's almost like a Popeye the Sailor type of thing where like he'll talk and then like he'll mumble some stuff underneath, and the stuff he mumbles is much better than what he was saying. It's like, yeah.
Well, Lewis Brightriven says that box office was 8.4 million, so it obviously didn't do well its first run in theaters.
No, like I said, it's become much more of a cult classic. People who love animation and who love stuff that they would know that. And yeah, it's like I said, it wasn't a big hit, but I love Baby's Kid. I always love that. It's just fun. It's got heart, you know. That's the thing too. Mm-hmm. Is like they don't hit you over the head. I mean, yeah, there's a little bit of message in there about treating people equally and all that kind of stuff, of course. But they don't hit you over the head with it like they would today. It's much mm-hmm. more about heart, and they talk about like things like, you know, how fathers are important in a family and a stable environment for kids and all the kind of things they would never want to talk about today in the Black community. They would never want to talk about that now, but back then they did. And again, mm-hmm. it's just a movie with a lot of heart and a lot of soul and a lot of humor, and I just love it.
Well, okay, I guess there's the highest recommendation from Sequential Treasures right there. Okay, now here's your fourth movie, a classic by
now,
anyone's.
This is the oldest movie I've picked, a total classic. Yes, Fantasia. Now, we all know Disney sucks today. There's no question about that. You know, it's hated on and rightfully so. But there was a time when quality mm-hmm. mattered to them, and they wanted to produce good family entertainment, and this is one of that. This is back when they did that type of thing. And to me, I just think when you're talking animated films, it's pretty much impossible to not mention something from Disney, from their at least from their back catalog, because they've just done so much work, and they've been mm-hmm. so influential and so notable over the decades. And of all the Disney films, this one's my favorite, because this movie, along with Tom and Jerry cartoons and Looney Tunes, is where I learned all about classical music and opera. Yep. Is from
that's
this
the only
stuff.
Place. Yeah, exactly. I never would have learned anything about classical music if it wasn't for cartoons.
And of course, you know, I love this poster because it shows you the two most well-known segments by people, which is, you know, Night on Bald Mountain and, of course, Mickey Mouse as the Sorcerer's Apprentice. That's what we know the movie for the best. But, yeah, let's see. Yeah, the voice work of Mickey Mouse was, of course, by Walt Disney himself. And in a 1985 remastered version, Tim Matheson is a narrator on the film. So.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Because I've seen the original a couple times, but I don't know that I've seen the remastered one.
Yeah, and let's see. Now, some of the stuff I found out here is the animator secretly molded elements of the sorcerer, not Mickey Mouse, but the sorcerer he's working for. On Walt Disney himself, the raised eyebrow was regarded as a dead giveaway. And the character's name was Yen Sid, which is Disney spelled backwards. So they kind of based the sorcerer, his mannerisms, his look, and even his name off of Walt Disney himself.
Wow. I did not know that.
And at 125 minutes in length, this is the longest Disney animated feature.
Wow, that's over 2 hours. That's pretty amazing, because usually you wouldn't see these go much longer than 90 minutes. I mean, that was 2 hours. That's a long animated film, man. Just the amount of
and
work.
Speaking of long, after 80 years since its release, Disney still receives complaints from parents claiming Night on Bald Mountain terrified their children.
That was my favorite scene in the whole movie. Of course, I didn't see this when I was a kid. I, you know, saw it as an adult, but that was still my favorite sequence in the whole movie. But gee, big
it is also there. Mickey Mouse's first appearance in an animated feature film from Disney.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Interesting.
Now I got a piece for you, Aaron, that I think you, being the master of the old horror, like you love the old Hammer horror.
I know you're going with this, but go ahead.
Yes. Bela Lugosi served as a live action model for the demon god in The Night in Bald Mountain, and spent several days trying to, you know, help them develop the character, his motions, his looks, his but then Bill Tatiala, the animator in charge of it, said that he was dissatisfied with Lugosi's performance and had the sequence director pose for the cameras. Thus, it's Wilfred Jackson, not Lugosi, who appeared on screen as the demon.
Oh my gosh! Now that part I didn't know, but it's funny. that
somebody unsatisfied with Bela Lugosi's performance.
Yeah, gee, I can't imagine. Now, see, I'm not a huge Lugosi fan. I would never considered him a great actor, but like I always thought that Karloff was really good, but I never thought Lugosi was. And I think that's kind of funny that they would go, an animation director would go, yeah, you just, I know your performance isn't hitting it, man. Sorry.
And the last bit of info I got here. Now, remember, folks, this original Fantasia 2000, I saw it. It's not as good as the original, though. It's not even close. I mean, it's okay, but it's not even close.
I did like it, though. Well, of course, but for a sequel, for what it was, I actually liked that quite a bit. But go ahead.
But the original here came out in 1940. Now, what was going on in 1940 in the world?
Well, we were just about, it was just prior to World War II. So they, I mean, that stuff was ramping up.
It was prior to us being in it, but the war begun in September of 39. So, of course, so during World War II, this film was banned in Japan. The imperial government feared that if Japanese audiences saw that Americans were capable of creating such beautiful works of art, the nation would be demoralized. The Imperial Ministry of Japan Navy secretly violated the ban and showed this film to Matsu Seo, an artist who had previously directed several animated short films, and the goal was to produce an animated film on par with Fantasia to touch the young public and arousing patriotic sentiment in the Japanese people. So they banned this film from being seen because they didn't want them to think that Americans could create such things, but to let one artist in Japan watch it so he could try to create a Japanese copy to inspire patriotism.
But did he?
Don't know. They don't know if it happened. Don't know if he made one or if it didn't. Where I got my information didn't tell me that, but that's what the Imperial Japanese government did. I just thought it was like amazing. Wow, they banned the film in Japan during the war. Wow.
That's interesting. Wow.
But of course, let's see a still from this classic.
Yes, I was reading the chat there. Didn't bring up, of course. This sequence is so great.
You know, it is what everybody remembers the film for probably more than anything else is this. And there's the sorcerer based off of Walt Disney.
Well, I'm going to assume he had a pretty good sense of humor about it.
They said the thing with the eyebrow was, is whenever he would cock that eyebrow that way, they knew they were in for it because he wasn't happy about something. that's the look.
Yeah. Can you imagine? Oh, that's the horrifying Disney behind the scenes, you know. Cracking the whip on the animators, but at least he knew his audience, and he did have a sensibility of, despite like his human flaws, like we all have, he was at least tried to make sure.
Hey, what's this here, Fritchie Schnitzel? What is this?
Oh boy, the chat has much better taste in animated films than this guy. Wow. Yeah, I take a little heat today, huh? Oh, my goodness.
Look, like I said, I know we all hate Disney now, and rightfully so, but there was a time they produced good work like this.
Yeah, I mean, I would not argue with this film as being on anybody's, top 10 or top 5 animated film list. I mean, that's what we got. I mean, there wasn't a lot of options. In the 70s, it was Ralph Bakshi and a few others, like the heavy metal film or something like that. But if you wanted to see good animated films, it was Disney or nothing for the most part. So,
yeah, they pretty much dominated.
Fantasia.
Isn't that funny? When Disney dominated, they produced quality. And now that there's other studios and others who do it, like DreamWorks and, all these other companies that can do them, they produce garbage.
Exactly. Makes no sense. What's going on in society? It's out of control. All right. Now, this is a little bit off. Now, maybe
this is another esoteric one. Yes. Another personal favorite of mine. I was introduced to by a friend.
They'll come back to you on this one, probably.
Hey, Good Looking by Ralph Bakshi. There you go. The guy who did The Wizards and Fritz the Cat This is his sort of love letter to the 1950s. Yes, it's got great voice work here from Richard Romanus, Danny Wells, and Philip Michael Thomas from Miami Vice fame.
Ooh, look at that.
And what it's about, this guy who meets up with an old woman on the street in like what you would say is the modern time of the era here when this takes this, and she shows him an old leather jacket that's all these zippers on it, and he goes into a story about the jacket, and it's his story. And it's a story of this guy, Vinny, and the night he went out and met a girl, kind of fell in love, and then ended up in a street fight with the rival gang that they had. And it's just like a love letter to the 50s type of stuff that people think about when you think of the 50s. And, you know, Bakshi's art style is just, you know, incredible. Go ahead and show the art right now. We'll show the still right now before I can get any info for you guys. This is the art. This is the artistry you saw in this film.
If this doesn't say Ralph Bakshi, I don't know what does.
That's why I chose it. There you go, folks. Ralph Bakshi right there. This is why we love him.
Yep. In a nutshell.
But actually, this film, although it's all animated now, originally it was meant to be only Vinny, Roz, his girl here, his friend Crazy, and Crazy's girlfriend Eva. They were the only ones to be animated, and everything else was going to be live action. So it's going to be more like in the vein of like Who Framed Roger Rabbit. And this is back in like 1977 when Bakshi did this. And they at first the studio loved it, but then they came back a little while later and said, yeah, you know, it's ridiculous. No one would buy, you know, animated characters walking around in the real world. That's stupid. We don't want that. So they made Bakshi go back and redo it all animated. And so it took him 5 years to get done because he had to go back and rework everything into complete animation. So that's why it came out in 1982.
Well, some people are saying that's Phil Diaz there. So it may be. I wonder if Phil wasn't around back then. No,
no, Phil wasn't around. That's Phil's dad.
Yeah, there you go. That's right.
That's Phil's dad. the Warner executives, they just said it was too unbelievable to have a film that was part animation and part live action. And they say people also think that the controversy around Bakshi's film Coonskin from 75 was also a contentious factor for the studios.
I'm sure that's true.
So, he took 5 years. Yeah. And Bakshi had to pay himself to do this, to rework everything. He had to pay himself to do the film.
Geez. That's dedication to your craft, right? I mean, if it's if you're not getting bankrolled and you it's coming out of your own pocket to finish it, you must be pretty passionate about it.
One of the live action scenes that was removed from the film featured a glam punk band called the New York Dolls, which I'm guessing must have been a big band back in the 70s, maybe. I don't know.
I know the name. I'm not familiar with their music, or at least off the top of my head, but I do know the name. So,
and then a good chunk of the movie was shot during the night purely because it was easier for Bakshi to conceal things in shadows. That's one of those technical shortcuts.
Right? Yeah, well, low budget, right? You got to figure out ways to stay within your budget. So that's where you get creative.
One of the most memorable scenes of the film is the breakdancing scene where the other gang members from the group, the Black Chaplains, demonstrate their pop, lock, rumble techniques. And, Bakshi had hired a dancer named Tony Basil and her dance group known as the Lockers. Tony Basil from Mickey.
Mickey, you're so fine. Yep.
And which later that style developed into what we now know as breakdancing, which was an unheard of style in the 1970s. So in a way, this film has the very first breakdancing done ever anywhere shown is in this film.
What year was this?
82 is when the film came out, but it was done originally with the live action in 77. So...
with breakdancing. Wow. How about that?
Yeah. Breakdancing wasn't big until the 80s.
He says, you don't know the New York Dolls? I said I knew the New York Dolls. I just don't know their music. I know of them. I know of them. Jeez. So,
this movie definitely has racial overtones in it, in some of the stuff that's said. That is, there's this one scene with Vinny where he's on the beach and he's meeting up with the leader of the Black Chaplains, who's a black guy. And he goes, hey, you're the leader of the Black Chaplains. It's my job to know where you, what you're doing. And he asks me, how do you know what I'm doing? He goes, you're the leader of the Black Chaplains. It's my job to know what you're doing. He goes, oh yeah? Well, where was I last night, effer? And then Vinny just like kind of smirks and goes, eating watermelon. And it's like, that would never fly today.
Oh my gosh. You could
never get that joke in there today.
No. Account 964 says breakdancing wouldn't exist if it weren't for Ralph Bakshi.
That's kind of what I'm taking from what I learned about the film. So yes. Thank you, Ralph Bakshi, for breakdancing.
Exactly, man. Well, I'm aware of it, but have not seen it, much like the New York Dolls.
Now this is one that I'm thinking everybody probably expected of me. So I let's not disappoint them any longer.
That's right. Give them one that be predictable. There it is.
Transformers. There it is, folks. You knew this was coming. And in case you're thinking, oh, he's just fronting. No, folks. I am not. I own the soundtrack on CD. That is how diehard I am. This movie. I don't, you know, this, if you are of the age, if you are Generation X, this is your movie right here. This is the animated movie you will always remember. I even remember some of the spots for it. And I remember there's the one spot, the guy doing the voiceover, he's like, the movie's so big, you'll have to see it twice to take it all in. And it's just so epic the way they... But yes, 1986, Transformers the movie with, you know, Peter Cullen, Frank Welker, Chris Latta, Scatman Crothers, Jack Angel, Casey Kasem, Eric Idle from Monty Python, who is Wreck-Gar. He is in this film. Dan Gilvezen, who is Bumblebee, but he's also Peter Parker, Spider-Man from Spider-Man and His Amazing Friends. Michael Bell, Don Machis Jr., who, if you don't know who that is, do you remember Micro Machines, the little tiny toys?
Yeah.
Remember the guy that did all the fast talking when he did the commercials? That's him. He's a voice in this movie. Judd Nelson, Robert Stack, the great Leonard Nimoy, and the even greater Orson Welles. I mean, it's an all-star cast of voices. Everybody who was doing voices in the 80s, along with some superstars. How much bigger can you make it?
Oh, my gosh. I don't even – what year was this?
86.
Okay. I was 12 years old,
and I don't care who you are. If you're a 12-year-old and you were in the theater and you watched this film, when Optimus Prime dies, you cried. I don't care. Don't lie. I know you don't want your friends to know. You didn't tell anybody about it, but you cried when you saw him die.
Oh, my gosh. I was in film school at the time, so that's I wasn't watching this. I have to admit, I recall when it came out, but I did never go see it.
To get out of the way first, this was Orson Welles' final film before his death on October 10th of 1985 at the age of 70. He recorded his lines 5 days before.
Oh, my gosh. Wow. So you're saying Transformers killed Orson Welles? Account 964 says, when Orson Welles showed up to do the voice of Unicron, he said, I'm under the understanding that I'm going to play a planet.
Well, considering how overweight he was, maybe he took that personal.
He may have.
Oh, also, the great Scatman Crothers, he died on November 22nd of 86, and this is his final film before his death.
Holy crap.
At 76.
This movie killed a lot of famous...
If you know your lore with the series, the cartoon series, after the movie, they became the ones in the regular series. The first two seasons were like Optimus Prime and Megatron, and then the movie came out, and then the new generation takes over in season 3. And in the very first episode of it, there's a scene where they're like doing Olympics or something on Cybertron, and one of the characters is Jazz, who was Scatman Crothers' character that he voiced. And you see Jazz, and he runs through, and he does some like Olympic stuff, and then he's standing there at the end, like, you know, with his hands raised in victory, but he never speaks, and that's why, because Scatman Crothers had passed away before that was done.
Oh my gosh. Danky Frankie says he dies. How about a spoiler alert?
Oh, I'm sorry. I spoiled a movie from like 40 years ago, guys. Sorry about that.
Oh my gosh. That's pretty amazing, man. That both those guys, that's like their last film.
But here's the thing. Bob Holt is uncredited as Unicron's Roar. There's a couple scenes in the film where the Unicron roars, and it's Bob Holt, not Orson Welles, that does it. The roar is from the stock sound library, Sunbow, who made Transformers and the 1982 Incredible Hulk cartoon series, which is where the roar comes from.
Not enough.
The same roar Unicron does is the roar that Bob Holt did for the Hulk in 82 on the cartoon series.
Really?
It just pulled it from the library and used it. So, you know, there's another Marvel tie. Besides putting out the comic, there's another Marvel tie to Transformers. Let's see. The bands who sing on the soundtrack, on a song called Nothing's Going to Stand in Our Way and Hunger are listed on the soundtrack as Spectre General, which I can testify to. But the band's actual name is Kick Axe. When the soundtrack was being assembled, they thought that name sounded too threatening, so they named them as Spectre General, and the band was not notified of that change of name. They had them sing the songs and do their music and then just change their name without even telling them.
Oh my gosh. That's so typical. I'm not surprised to hear that at all. We'll just change the band's name. They don't need to know. You're like, geez, man.
That's and then funny, here's another one. About Orson Welles, when asked about his role, Orson Welles couldn't remember the name of the character of Unicron, and so he described his role as a big toy who attacks a bunch of smaller toys.
Oh my gosh, that's so great.
We hear you, Luke. Holla, Luke, we hear you.
Fire and Ice was a good, says Joseph Pantalone. It was. I just watched that for the first time. About a month ago, had more.
The Matrix of Leadership, which is like kind of the key in the whole movie, as you know, it's the Matrix of Leadership passing from one to another, you know, never came up in early drafts of the film. And yet it's the driving force behind the whole plot of the movie when you watch it. It's just crazy stuff. Crazy stuff. But here's the big one that I found. Okay. The movie was produced at the same time as the G.I. Joe movie because it was done by the same company. It had been agreed that both movies would suffer the loss of the lead heroes, Optimus Prime and Duke. But production on G.I. Joe got started late, and so Transformers ended up being completed first. It was originally going to be G.I. Joe, then Transformers, but the production got delayed, and so it went the other way. And because Optimus Prime's death so traumatized kids, that's why in the G.I. Joe movie, they only put Duke in a coma and he wakes up in the end.
Wow.
So what happens in this film directly affected the G.I. Joe movie.
I'm not surprised that they would make a change like that and say, you know, oh, the audience doesn't like this. We can't do this anymore. Stop it. You know? Of course, I don't care who you were,
Optimus Prime dies, you cried. If you were a Gen Xer in that audience, you cried at the death of Optimus Prime. And like I said, this still scene right here, this is what you went to the movie for right here. You wanted this, the final confrontation between Prime and Megatron.
Did it live up to your expectations, though?
Oh, yeah, it did. It lived up to mine. I don't know about other people's.
Well, I mean, no, I'm just saying... For you, did it live up to your expectations, the confrontation between the two? Okay. Well, then, you know, you have to walk away satisfied then. Me, Transformers, I never got into those at all. And the only Transformers stuff I ever watched was Beast Wars with my son when he was little, with that television show. When they had it, but I missed it.
I didn't care for too many liberties taken. You know, Optimus Primal because he's a gorilla. It's like, one I saw not too long ago. They did in 2010 was called Transformers Prime, which sort of reworked the original G1 series, and he took it in a more serious direction. It was a little less camp than the original had, and a lot more seriousness. And at first, I was a little wary on it. But then when I understood, oh, they're trying to go in a more serious direction, they wanted to take it seriously. Like, this is a serious secret war going on between robots in disguise. I kind of got into it, and I liked Transformers Prime. It was 2010 through 2012. They did that, and I liked that one. That was a good one. So, which is funny because that's Alex Kurtzman, one of the guys who ruined Star Trek, who worked on that. So,
one of the guys who ruined Star Trek, did you say?
Yes, Alex Kurtzman. If you've watched any of the recent he's behind Star Trek Discovery and Star Trek Picard and all this other crap that sucks.
Yeah, well, there's the original series and there's nothing else, but that's a conversation for another episode. all right. So let's get off these toy robots. As
to my final one.
Now this.
Again, another modern classic.
Yes. I love Shrek. This movie.
You know, Mike Myers, Eddie Murphy, Cameron Diaz, John Lithgow, and Jim Cummings, who, if that name isn't familiar to you, he's done tons of work for tons of different studios and lots of animation, Nickelodeon, Disney, all that. His best known voice, Darkwing Duck.
I met him. In fact, I sat in a van with him coming back from a convention someplace, going to the airport, and chatted him up a little bit. Interesting guy. Seemed really nice. I always remember he did the voice for Winnie the Pooh on the television series, which we used to watch with the kids. And then, I thought that was a really good show, by the way. And then he did the voice for the crazy hyena in The Lion King, the one that didn't really speak, but just did like sound effects. And
yeah,
that was Jim Cummings. So that's when I first, knew who that name was when I was on Winnie the Pooh. And then,
That's okay, Fritchie Schnitzel. You're allowed to be wrong. It's okay. It's not a problem for anybody. It's okay that you're wrong. It's fine. Just relax.
You're not pulling any punches today, man.
A coronary, dude. You're okay. It's okay. You're allowed to be wrong. I promise. I promise. No one's going to hurt you for being wrong. We're not SJWs here. We're not going to cancel you because you're wrong.
It's so nice for you to take the heat instead of me all the time.
Oh, don't worry. I'm sure they'll probably have heat for you.
Yeah, that's right. My turn hasn't come yet.
Yeah, that's right. It's just not your turn yet. That's all.
Well, you do have a shot from the film here. It's a pretty funny scene when he blew up. Was that a frog that he blew up and turned into a balloon?
Some kind of lizard. Yeah, he made a balloon for her.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and that just. It's just like, there it is. It's that, but it's like taking a classic fairy tale and turning it on its head, the way they did this with, like, the unlikely hero is an ogre. He's normally would be the bad guy. Instead, he's the hero. I just thought it was hilarious. A nice twist on your expectations. Now the principal actors never met each other during any of their readings. They were never like in the room together, like running scenes and stuff. No. And actor John Lithgow, who played Lord Farquaad, said that he was disappointed he never got to work directly with Myers, Cameron, or Murphy.
Yeah, that's got to be the weird thing, is because everybody goes in there in animated features for the most part, or at TV. They just go in, they do their lines, no one else is around. And
somebody on the other side of that wall or whatever who reads you, you hear them on the headset,
right,
and they
read
the line.
You're
and
not
you...
working with the other. Yeah. You don't have three or four actors in there at the same time, doing, they each do it individually. And if someone did it before you, they'll play back, their lines. Or if not, like you said, they got someone in the producer's room reading those lines to you that you play off of. But yeah, that's a weird experience. And you go see the movie and you're like, you're in these scenes with people that you never met. But it's the same thing again. Well, it all comes
Joel
back.
Asher to hits up on.
I was just going to say
Skull
real
Nasher
quickly
hits up on something I was going to go on about right here in a second here. Hit Skull Nasher right there. He makes a point that goes right into my next bit of info that I gained. Yes, Farley was originally supposed to be Shrek. Yes, but after he died, they gave it to Mike Myers, and it says Mike Myers was hesitant about succeeding him in the role due to being friends and believing it was disrespectful to do so. But after thinking it over and the producers telling Myers, can't we just settle this over a pint? He decided to take on the role, and that line was eventually used in the final cut of the film too. Can't we just talk about this over? Can't we just settle this over a pint?
A pint? Yep. Do you have more info you're going to drop? Because I'll drop something.
Oh, yeah, I got a few more bits here. Okay. Eddie Murphy.
You're probably going to drop it, so I'll let you do it.
Eddie Murphy says that this is his best. He considers his best work is the Shrek series of films is his mm-hmm. best work. Before they took John Lithgow as Lord Farquaad, they actually asked the late Alan Rickman to be Lord Farquaad, but instead he passed on that to go do Professor Snape's in the Harry Potter films instead.
Probably
and then
a
they
good
passed
choice.
To John Lithgow.
Probably a good choice. H is for Heretic, $2. Thank you very much. He says it's a piece of the action all over again.
That's right. You guys were allowed to be wrong, guys. I don't have a problem with that. That's perfectly fine.
Now, Danky Frank says Orson Welles was originally going to be Shrek. That's not true. Orson Welles was long gone.
Actually, you know what? I could see if he'd still been alive, maybe they would have asked him. I don't know.
Yeah.
Let's see. Now, there are rumors that Lord Farquaad was based on former Disney CEO Michael Eisner. Uh-huh. And if the rumor is true, it could be a deliberate attack by his former partner, Jeffrey Katzenberg, who worked on the film. His way of sticking it to his former partner and saying, yeah, this guy's based on him.
That doesn't surprise me that would be if that were true, that would not surprise me.
And of course, one last bit, of course, we have to, because this is DreamWorks that made this, not any of the big studios at the time. And of course, Disney is always going to be involved when you're doing animation. And so prior to the release of the film, DreamWorks lawyers viewed everything since there were concerns Disney might sue over the not so subtle satirical references to the company's films and theme parks in the film.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah. little side things like the seven dwarves. There's a scene where they got the seven dwarves and they're putting Snow White up on the table. He's like, hey, get her off the table. And it's like, you know, we know how Disney is with their litigiousness.
Mm-hmm. No, that was
I love it. It's a fun movie. It was a fairy tale put on its side of its head. And you know, Mike Myers is awesome. Eddie Murphy is awesome. You know, they're a great combo.
Well, here's a bit of information you didn't drop that I thought you were. Now, as my understanding, I had heard anyway that Mike Myers recorded all this, his lines with a British accent. And then when he heard it back, he was like, it just didn't work. And that's where he came up then and did the Scottish accent.
Yes.
And everybody liked that better. And that's what they went with. But I thought that was kind of interesting that he was like, he just didn't think the British accent worked for the character.
You didn't slay the dragon? It's on my to-do list.
Yeah, I mean, the Scottish accent was perfect. And I kept trying to think, well, how would he have sounded with a British accent? And I don't know that he's, you know, you always associate British accents with usually regal type characters. And so this was more of a, you know, Shrek's more of a hard drinking. You think of that as sort of a Scottish or an Irish, you know, character that... It fit much better, but it's funny that he would record the entire all of his lines and with that accent, then go.
Well, the accent he uses here is the same one he used for Fat Bastard in the Austin Power movie.
Oh my gosh, that's funny. Okay, so that is your list. It's controversial apparently with the chat. Now let's see if I can stir up any dust. Well, my first choice is probably going to piss off the same people that you're pissing off. But this, I can't tell you why, but I love this movie. I can tell you why. I love the character design. I love the animation. I love Mandy Moore. His voice acting in this. This movie, and granted, this movie, I watched this a ton with my daughter. And so you always associate things like that with your kids or whatever. And I just always felt this movie was incredibly charming. The scene where they're in what I want to call it. It's not a tavern, but the... with these dudes, is like one of my favorite things, scenes in an animated film ever. I just thought this was, I'm going to actually go out and say this is maybe my favorite Disney film. I liked everything about it. And the harsh ending, right? Like, you got Mother Gothel, who, what she did, I was always torn by how bad of a villain this character really was, because, yeah, she kidnapped this kid. And as a parent, that's like the worst feeling in the world, to think that, you know, someone would kidnap your child, right? And they didn't get to see their child again until she was an adult. I mean, that's just heartbreaking, number one. So yeah, it's a horrible thing what Mother Gothel did, but she never killed her or really mistreated her. She just used her to keep herself young. But then she has this brutal death ending that was really kind of heavy at the end, where she kind of trips and falls out the window as she's aging really quickly, and actually turns to dust as she hits the ground at the bottom of the tower. Spoiler. So there's just all
never seen this one. I've never seen Tangled.
Oh, I just ruined it for you. Sorry.
That's okay. But Skullmasher here says the horse is the best character.
Yeah, he's hilarious. And I thought the humor in this movie was really great. I just found, again, Mandy Moore's performance and the character design of just charming as all get out. And so it just really, it really stuck with me. And if I didn't have a daughter, I may never even have watched it. But the animation is top notch. You know, it's like Pixar at its best, even though it's not Pixar, but it was about the time I think Disney probably bought Pixar, or right after that, where they were kind of probably stealing their techniques from them. But yeah, I just absolutely love this movie. So there you go.
Well, that's the Disney way anymore. Why create something original and innovative when you just buy off somebody else's?
That's right. But this was still back before.
Oh, there it is, Fritchie Schnitzel. He's giving you heat already.
Oh, see, actually, no, I hate My Little Pony. If that makes you feel better, I'm going to announce right now that there are no anime films in my my list here, because I've never watched any. Okay, and I know there's some allegedly brilliant anime films out there, but I have not seen them. And I promise I will watch them, just as I watched Night of the Creeps. Ugh. So anyway, but moving right along. This really, this came out not too long ago and really sort of captured my fancy. This, of course, is Klaus, or Claus, however you want to pronounce that. Now, this is an interesting film because the director, I believe, is South American. I'm not going to say where he's from because I'm not 100% sure, but this started out as a Kickstarter or a crowdfunder project. And I remember seeing a scene of the animation on the crowdfunding site, and I was blown away by it because it's traditional animation. It's not CGI at all, but they created like new techniques that make it almost feels like a CGI film, but it's all hand drawn. And so anything that's hand drawn now, it's like it's like claymation. Yeah. You know, the amount of work that goes into it, you've got to give them respect. But I absolutely love this film. It's charming. I know some people actually don't like it, but I just think the animation is fantastic, and I find the story charming. And that's what I'm looking for a lot of times in animated films. Is, you know, do I get a warm fuzzy inside when I, you know, after I watch the film or not? And this one really does. I just love it. And this little clip here, not a clip, but this shot from the movie. This is near the end, after the town has been sort of restored to a joyful place. This kind of reminded me of my experience of being at Christmas markets in Germany. Shelley and I had the good fortune of being invited to a show in Germany. And it was right, I was in November, so it's cold, but they had these Christmas markets were set up, and It was very similar to this. And so it brought back these kind of fond memories when this scene here of my experiences there in Paris, but mostly in Germany. We visited some small towns, and they had these Christmas markets set up, and they were just wonderful. They were just great. And so again, a movie that has certain scenes in it that sort of remind you of a personal experience that kind of makes you feel good about it. But just in terms of the animation in this film was enough to carry it for me, but I actually enjoyed the story as well. So,
well, it seems people aren't too interested in the animation style of this. Everyone's talking anime films right now.
Because I made the list by saying that I did not include any anime films in this.
If anybody wants anime films, I'll throw in a couple I know I've seen. Golden Boy and Angel Cop. So there you go. I've seen some anime films.
Art Tiber has better taste in animation, guys. At least he's seen Akira. Oh, my gosh. No, see, there you go. I've watched Klaus every year since Netflix first released it. It's on my Christmas movie list. I'm not someone that gets, even when I was in film school and everybody was talking about, you know, all these great foreign films, 400 Blows and, you know, Truffaut and Fellini and all these guys, I would tell my friends in film school, I would say, I would rather watch Friday the 13th Part 3 than the best foreign film. And it would just infuriate them. And I've never been an anime fan. I've never liked the style.
I like some of it. I think some of it's really well done. Howl's Moving Castle was a great film. I like that one a lot. It almost, if I would have done one more in my list, I probably would have had Howl's Moving Castle on there. I like that a lot. Anime has its place, and you know, but it is almost in some ways a different beast from like the animation we're talking about, the stuff we've shown. It's almost a different beast when you go into anime.
Right. Now, Luffy is God says, Howl's Moving Castle, my friend, Totoro, Castle of Cogliostro. I was told this week, and I have to see that. And of course, Akira, everybody's always talked about that for ages.
Dan the Pizza Man says he's enjoying our list. So at least that's okay. Somebody that's having some good time with this.
That's right. Anybody besides that, us. If you like pizza, you don't like anime. I don't think that. America. I do want to check out some of those anime classics because everybody says they're great, so there must be some truth to that. I just the visual style.
Most of my anime watching though was not in the film genres. It was television. You know, uh-huh. I saw Battle of the Planets. I saw the Macross Saga. I saw all this stuff. It was Japanese stuff that was done on but it was on television. I never saw the major motion picture type stuff. I didn't see the full length features that way. I was the more episodic stuff.
Anti Entity says wrong, Aaron. I assume that's an anime reference that she does not agree with me on, and that's totally fine. We encourage disagreement in this chat. And we know we're going to get, anytime you pick a list, you're picking a fight. So, okay, here we go. Let's go way back to 1977, if you don't mind. And now I'm not going to lie to you and tell you this is a great film. I'm just going to tell you that I really liked it.
Well, that's what these are. These are our favorites. It doesn't have to be everybody loves. It's you love it.
Now, first of all, you have this great William Stout movie poster. Now, I know Stout, and as far as I know, he still remembers me. And so, you know, when you see this movie poster, you're like, okay, I got to go see that. Evil One for $2. Thank you. No anime, but CG movies. What the F, guys? I'm a movie buff. CG
movies. You're going to be sorry later on in the stream that you said that, Evil One. You're going to be sad. I'm not going to say anything else about it. I'm just saying you're going to be sorry you said that later on in the stream. That's all I'm going to say.
Well, now, I've only picked one movie that had CG in it, didn't I? Yeah, I just picked one. Well, everything else I've got here is traditional. This is rotoscope, so that means that worse. But I like the character designs in this, and it was a movie we went and saw. Gosh, how old was I? This came out in 77, 78, I think is the first year I saw it. So I don't think actually I saw this until 1980, though, because I remember we drove to a second run theater to see this. So I think I missed it when it first came out, because I would have been like 12 or 13 when this came out. And so I can't really see my mom.
Yes, yes, anti-entity. Yes, I know that. I know that Battle of the Planets was originally Gotcha Man. I understand it. They added in the Zark, seven Zark scenes in Battle of the Planets. That's what they did to change it. I know this. I've studied this. I told you, I live these cartoons. I grew up with that stuff.
I know that he meant, when he said CG, he meant CGI. But thank you for clarification. But we went and saw this. This is the first movie, animated film I ever saw that had blood in it and swearing. So it was really a bizarre experience to sit there in the theater and see animated characters swearing or guys getting shot and bleeding all over the ground. You're just like, so that sort of stuck with me. But also one of the great things about this, beside the movie poster, was that the great Mike Ploog worked on this film, and he did all the character design work on this. But he also, if you remember, at the beginning of the movie, they tell the origin of how the Earth, what happened to the Earth, and how they got to the state that they're in, you know, the nuclear war and all that kind of stuff. Yep. And they're all done with still illustrations, and those were all done by Mike Ploog. So
see Ploog there. That's definitely that you can tell that's Ploog.
Yeah. And again, I didn't know him at the time, but I met him years later after this. And so, but I always thought the illustrations at the start of this book, and I knew who Mike Ploog was because I was a comic book fan, but I didn't know him personally. But I remember seeing this in the theaters, you know, and going, God, that looks like Ploog, you know, and it turned out that it was. And so he did a bunch of illustrations that were used in the opening sequence of this film that makes it really cool, even though the story is, it's okay. I was watching an interview with Bill Stout, and Stout has never seen this movie. And they asked him, well, why haven't you seen it? And he goes, well, because everybody I know has seen it and told me that I'd be disappointed if I saw it. So he goes, I've never watched it. But it's one that it's stuck with me. I have the original movie poster. Shelly doesn't like the movie poster, so I get to hang it up every once in a while to drive her nuts.
That and alligator.
Yeah, that and alligator. And anything with Dark Crystal. She hates the Dark Crystal. And so I've got that. That doesn't really count as an animated film, but I do have the movie poster. All right, here's one that I this movie is so funny that I had to put it on here. Now, I was never initially was not a SpongeBob fan, and it just, you know, because the animation I thought was crappy and the character designs I thought were bad. But my son started watching it when he was little. And then I started watching it with him because I wasn't going to let my kid watch something. I didn't know what it was. And then I was like, okay, this is the funniest show I've ever seen in my life. And so then when the first movie came out, we went and saw it at the theaters. And it was kind of odd. But then the more you watch this movie, the funnier it gets. It's kind of like Napoleon Dynamite, right? It's like the first time you watch it, you scratch your head and go, I'm not sure what I just watched. Then you watch it again and it starts getting funnier and funnier and funnier. I think this movie is hilarious, and that is why it's on here. But there's also the great scene in this film where SpongeBob at the end of the movie rocks out and plays I'm a Goofy Goober. And it's played to the tune of I Wanna Rock by Twisted Sister. But it's got, you know, they totally redid it. And I actually think the lead guitar solo in this section of the film is better than the lead guitar solo in the actual song they were ripping off by Twisted Sister. So we watch this scene and just crack up. So I don't know. What do you guys? There you go. There you go. Kevin Thomas says SpongeBob peaked with this. It's an all-time classic. Thank you. Yeah, he's like, that is the one with Hasselhoff. So that movie gets a pass. Yeah, it has David Hasselhoff in it at the end. Look at Skullnasher. Napoleon Dynamite sucks. I don't think you've seen it enough. You have to watch Napoleon Dynamite multiple times before it sort of resonates with you. It's kind of like Big Trouble in Little China. The first time you watch that movie, you're scratching your head going, I'm not sure what I just watched. But the more you watch it, the funnier and greater it becomes. So
I don't think that's necessarily true. Like Napoleon Dynamite, I love the scene when the bus pulls up and the guy shoots the cow. That's hilarious. The bus full of kids.
I
got some of the humor right away. Same with Big Trouble in Little China. We really shook the pillars of heaven, didn't we, Wang? I mean, come on.
The first time I saw Big Trouble in Little China, I loved it, but I was like sort of, I wasn't sure how to take all of it. You know, I wasn't really sure what Carpenter's intent was. And the more I watch it, then you start to understand exactly what his sense of humor is and what he was going for. And the movie just becomes great the more you watch it, I think. And the same with, this is one of those movies. I'll watch this whenever it's on because it just cracks me up.
I don't know. So, I just always saw SpongeBob as like that show that people watch at like 2 o'clock in the morning when they're stoned out and eating Taco Bell.
Well, I was never.
Dude, that's so funny.
I was never. No, that was Beavis and Butthead. That's a show I never got. All right. I watched that show a couple times. I was like, what is this? But
I didn't care for Beavis and Butthead either, but I did like Daria. Daria was a great show.
Okay.
Much more cerebral.
All right. Well, okay. I don't know if I'm stirring up controversy or just getting people to scratch their heads at this point, but this is.
Oh, wow. Folsom coming in with some knowledge for you right there.
They filmed Napoleon near me. I live it every day. They filmed that in Idaho, didn't they? Isn't that like in some small town or small city in Idaho? I think they filmed that. I'm not sure, but I think that's true. All right, now I put this one up here because I needed one more, but then I thought of another one later, and I've actually got it on the list after this. But I love this movie. I think this is funny. This movie cracks me up. This, of course, was during that run of Disney formula princess films. But this one, I just enjoy this movie. I like the monsters. James Woods as, Hades is hysterical in this movie. And I love the Megan character. I can't remember who plays, but I love her voice. And her attitude in this film. And again, I have to admit that a lot of these movies I watched multiple times because my kids were of that age and they were watching these movies. And so I'd watch them over and over again. And this is the one that I can watch because I just think it's funny. And I like the Titans, you know, the big monster Titans at the end. And we used to go out to McDonald's and they had those. You could collect the Hercules toys.
Oh, just admit the truth, Aaron. You love this character because it reminds you of Showtime when she was younger. That's what it is.
That's exactly it. No, I do. I love her voice and her kind of smart aleck delivery and character. I don't know. What's everybody saying? They're saying that Aaron, you're an idiot. It's probably what they're saying. There you go. Diablo Dame says Hercules is my favorite kids movie. I heard that Michael B. Jordan is a possibility to play Hercules in Disney's
favorite movie.
Oh, geez.
Yeah, her kids' Dame favorite movie. Hercules is her kids' favorite movie.
Right. Is my kid's favorite. You're right. That's what I meant to say. Let's see. I had to tell them just because it's animated, it's not for kids. Yeah, there you go. Kevin Thomas is backing me up. He loved the Hercules art style. One of my favorite Disney flicks. Yeah, who was this based on? Al Hirschfeld, wasn't it? I believe that's what this art style was based on. And that was the kind of cool thing that Disney was doing at a time. If you remember when they did the Atlantis film, right? That was based on Mike Mignola's art style. And so they would do that. They would pick like an artist that kind of represented what they're going for. And then they would, you know, it would be represented in the animation, which I thought was pretty cool. Oh man. Live action Hercules rewritten by Ta-Nehisi Coates. Oh, that's going to be great. God. Yeah. But this classic, Danny DeVito, of course, is in it. And I don't know. It's got a good romantic storyline. It's got a good hero storyline. It's got a good self-sacrifice, you know, message about becoming a real hero by, you know, sacrificing for others and things like that. So I just, yeah, it's resonated with me. I like it. It's very watchable. And I guess maybe that's, you know, there's certain movies you watch intellectually and say, that's a really well done movie, but it's not a movie I'd watch a bunch. And then there's movies like, for me, like Hercules, that is just infinitely watchable. It's just kind of the way it's made and it's enjoyable. And you could watch it over and over again. You never get tired of it. And that's why it's on this list. But here's one that will resonate with the hardcore people here. This may be the greatest animated movie of all time that just never got the recognition it deserved.
See, all the people were bagging on you and me and said, oh, you're talking about the greatest animated films, your greatest animated films, and you'll have Iron Giant. Well, there it is, folks. See,
there
see
it
what
is.
Happens when you get ahead of yourselves? You see that's what happens right. when you talk trash? You see what happens?
This movie, first of all, is by Brad Bird, right? Who did the best Pixar movies like The Incredibles and stuff, which isn't on my list simply because it should have been. I like The Incredibles more than Hercules, but I kind of went back and forth and was like, I can watch Hercules more than I can watch the more often than I can watch The Incredibles without getting tired of it. The Incredibles is a great superhero movie, and some people say it's the best Fantastic Four movie ever made, and it probably is, or definitely is. But, and I love The Incredibles and Incredibles 2, but this movie, I was stunned because it's not a Disney movie, right? And back when my son was a kid, a young kid, was when we took him to see this, and of course he cried at the ending, and I almost got a little misty there at the ending of this film, and I think it has one of the greatest endings of any movie, not just animated, but of any movie period, that it just, you know, the self-sacrifice Iron Giant goes and saves the world basically. And then he dies and, you know, you remember him and everybody's like, oh yeah, he was great and blah, blah, blah. But then we get the ending, which gives us hope. So you go through this gamut of joy, incredible sadness, and then hope right at the end. I can't think of a better ending to a film off the top of my head than this movie had. And
I was going to put this on my list, but I figured you would probably choose it. So that's why I didn't.
Well, I appreciate it. You left me one to choose from. But, you know, I'll tell you some of the other movies that didn't make the list, but honorable mentions, I guess you'd call, like, I really liked American Pop by Ralph Bakshi back in the day when that came out. Maybe because I liked the music as much as anything else that they were playing in that movie.
I like Bakshi's Lord of the Rings film. I like how he did the Lord of the Rings in animated form. That was a great movie, the way he did that.
Fire and Ice was entertaining, but I didn't think it was great. But I appreciated the Frazetta-isms in the film. You know, I'm trying to think off the top of my head, because most of the animated films I saw were Disney films, you know, because they were the only ones really doing a lot of animated films up until just, you know, the past.
Yeah, like I said, up until like the 90s, they were like pretty much dominated.
Yeah, and it's strange that I don't have a Pixar movie on here, because I do like most of the Pixar films, but like Toy Story. Let's see, 1, 2. I thought 2 is better than 1 and 3. I thought was better than 2. I think Toy Story 3 was probably my favorite of all the Toy Story films. Although I like 2 a lot too. You know, I loved Ratatouille. So, you know, and of course The Incredibles is my favorite, but I always felt like The Incredibles, I couldn't really pick The Incredibles because I felt like I was jaded because I'm a comic book guy to begin with. So obviously I'm going to like a movie that has to do with superheroes, and it's sort of like, I'm like predisposed to like it. So I don't know if that's a fair judgment of how great a movie
is. Because like you can say the same thing about Heavy Metal. Heavy Metal is comic book related, heavily comic book related. And yet I put it on my list because it's a great movie. I'm a comic geek. Of course you're going to like Heavy Metal. Yeah, maybe, but it's a great movie and it belongs on a list.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you could pick a ton of different ones, but those are the ones that sort of, you know, that I've seen probably the most and continue to watch whenever they come on, or, you know, there's a moment where you go, well, okay, what are we going to default to? You know, and you go, oh, I'll default to one of these. And so I feel good. I feel confident about my choices, but you could throw The Incredibles in there as well. Yeah, there you go. Look at that. Now that's a good one too. Fleischer Superman almost feels rotoscoped in some of the sequences. I love Fleischer's Superman cartoons. But those
I have them on DVD. I have a DVD of all the Fleischer Supermans.
Well, those were serialized shorts. They weren't like, you know, they weren't animated film
features. Yeah.
Yeah, same thing with Johnny Quest. I love Johnny Quest, but those are, you know, the Hercules or whatever, those are, you know, TV shorts. So look at that. Got here late. Anyone pick Sword in the Stone or Robin Hood? I like Robin Hood. I don't love it, but I like it. And Sword in the Stone, I'm trying to remember. A lot of people like Black Cauldron too. And I don't think I've ever seen Black Cauldron.
Sword in the Stone's a good movie. Sword in the Stone's a good one.
That's King Arthur, right?
Yep.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's funny. You sit there. I mean, I like Fievel Goes West, you know? I actually like The Secret of Nim quite a bit too. I think that's a good movie. You know, I also like The Great Mouse Detective, but I'm partial to Sherlock Holmes type stuff. And so, you know, Vincent Price is Radigan. And, you know, there's a ton that you could, you know, reference. I even thought Spielberg's, was it Tintin? That recently, he did recently, I mean, with the last 10 years.
I think it was
pretty good. You know, so, you know, there's a lot to choose from there. But, we can't, yeah. No Land Before. Oh my gosh. That movie about killed me. Because the first one wasn't that great. And then the sequels just got progressively worse and worse and worse. So,
yes, Folsom, I agree. I like that one as well.
Bambi versus Godzilla.
Which was attached to the Godzilla 1985 movie, which is my favorite Godzilla film.
Bambi versus Godzilla.
Yeah. Well, no, it wasn't Bambi versus. It was Bambi meets Godzilla.
Oh, that's what it was. Yeah, and he just
that beautiful little scene of the deer eating of the grass, and there's a burnt, like right out of Monty Python. Burnt.
You know, a movie I also liked a lot was Dexter's Lab, Ego Trip, which was the Dexter's Laboratory movie that Jendy Tartakovsky made. I really like that too. We quote that quite a bit. So Treasure Planet. Now, this is interesting. Treasure Planet has some of the best animation you'll ever see. And yet it's considered really a crappy movie by most critics. And I don't know that I've sat through the entire thing, but I have watched some of it. And the whole concept I love. I don't know that I've sat through the whole thing. And I do want to watch all of it because I know the animation is fantastic from what I've seen in it. But I hear a lot of people don't like, or like critically, I don't know about fan-wise, because that's generally not going to be in sync with the critics. But critically, it really got panned when it came out. So I'm kind of curious about that. I'd like to see that. Fox and Hound.
Yes.
Kurt Russell and who else was in that? Because Kurt Russell was the dog. I can't remember who the fox was. But
that's a shot to the gut when you're watching that movie.
Yes. Watership Down is a great film. That is a great film. But the animation is not to a level that, you know, blows me away, but it is a great film. Titan AE, I never saw it.
I saw it once. It's okay. It's nothing revolutionary. It's nothing, you know, superlative. The animation's decent. The acting is decent. I mean, you got like, you know, I think it was Matt Damon's in it, and you got Drew Barrymore as a voice in it, and you got a few notable names, but it's nothing, you know, it feels like a pastiche of like other movies all put together and into one.
Yep. Let's say Luffy is God's Treasure Planet is the last drawn animation Disney ever made, if I'm not mistaken. No, wait a minute. Did they do Treasure Planet after the Mignola film? I just said it and I can't think of the name of Atlantis. No, Atlantis. Maybe Treasure Planet was after Atlantis. Somebody help me out here, but I think you're probably right. I'm not going to argue, especially since I don't know. So anyway, but anyway, we can talk about movies all day long. We also got to share some original art. So
as always, I'm going big for you guys. I brought two pieces to show, one published, one unpublished.
Let me see. I want to make sure I grab the right one first here.
And so make sure to show the published one first, Aaron.
The published one first. Then I got it in the right order. All right. I've got to go grab a piece real quick. It's hanging on the wall that I want to share. So I'll let you go ahead and talk about this. I'll be right back like in just a minute.
Well, this is the published version of it. This isn't the actual artwork, but there it is, folks. You were complaining about anime. Well, here it is. My piece is anime related. I have an original cover to Appleseed comic. It was done through Eclipse back in 1990. This is artwork by the great Adam Warren. And it's a cover, as you see, Book 3, Volume 4. I love the energy in it. I love the way he does all that little cross-hatching, the blast lines, all that detail. Actually, Aaron, if you go, that this is the published version. If you go over one, that's the actual artwork. You can see the actual art.
Okay. Now, this is by Adam Warren, huh?
Yes, this is Adam Warren who did this cover. Before his signature style that everybody knows now, this is like a few years before he did the Dirty Pair. This is when he was doing Amerimanga, more the original like style of it, you know, where it's more leaning towards the actual like anime style rather than his development of it. And again, I just love this. It's a very, just, and again, you just saw the version that was published. This is a lot brighter in the color. The colors really stand out in this a lot better, and I love it for that. And, you know, just in case there's anybody out here who doesn't know, the whole point of Appleseed is it's in a vast futuristic city built on the ashes of the Third World War. A police officer and her cyborg partner fight terrorism. Officer Kootenai and her cyborg partner must prevent terrorists from gaining control of the Olympic City computer and causing massive chaos. As they fight to stop the terrorists and preserve their society, the question of who is actually in the right, their society or the terrorists, continues to arise. So you got like all kinds of political stuff in this and like, you know, societal, like, you know, which way is the right way to go. You got in the wake of a world war, all kinds of great stuff, all the stuff Japanese anime does. They always love talking about like in the wake of a war. I guess ever since we bombed the crap out of them back in 45, that's just how they view the world. Is like everything is post-apocalyptic now. So, but yes, I love this cover. I saw it on eBay like 2017. I had to grab it. I'm like, oh, I got to get an Adam Warren cover. And so there you go, folks. You were all crying and whining. Where's the anime? Where's the anime? Here's the anime, folks, right here. Appleseed cover by Adam Warren.
Wow. And the fact that you have an original Adam Warren and it's in color, I mean, the color's on the board, right? Or that's not an overlay, yeah. Is it?
No, that's color on the board. And this thing is huge. It's like 14 by 20 on a thick piece of board.
That is pretty freaking awesome, I have to admit. I always liked Adam Warren's stuff. Like I said, I was never an anime fan, but you couldn't deny how good his stuff was, you know, or is.
Well, like I said, if you look at this, you see a little bit of the style he would later develop, like the face of the guy whose skull is getting crushed in. If you look at that face, that has a little bit of what he does now in it.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, the posing and like the shading on the armor of the guy getting crushed, that very much is what he does now. So you see little glints of what he would later produce.
Yeah, it's like I said, he was pretty hot there for a while in the 90s with that Dirty Pair, Dark Horse. So yeah, I mean, that's impressive that you got an original there. Let's see what else you got here.
Since we've done anime style art, of course we got to go into animation. Let's go with something a little more American. And it's not more American than G.I. Joe. And this is artist Joe Pekar, a full color. It's done in, I think it's a little bit of pen and ink, some colored pencils like on that rope there, and then watercolor. Mm-hmm. This is a beautiful nice piece. And I love his attention to detail. Look at her outfit, the red shoulder pad, the grenade hanging off, the pocket, the pouches on the boots, the stars on her glove. You know, all this is exactly how Scarlet looked in the TV cartoon. This is exactly how she looked. This is the outfit she wore. Perfect to a T. I love this attention to detail in this. I love the energy in it. I love, you know, the shattering glass she's coming through, the look on her face. Beautiful.
So this is a commission you got at a show, or did you pick this up later
It was something somebody was during the Comic Art Fans Comic Art Live. There was somebody selling some stuff and they had this piece and I bought it from them. Mm. So, but yeah, was done, I think, in 2009. So it's been a while, but this piece, I love the vibrancy of the color. I love the pose. I love the expression. It's so Scarlet, you know, that's exactly how she's crashing through a window. That's what she would do, just like this. And I loved how we got all the details of her costume correct from the TV series.
Dedication to excellence right there.
Yeah.
If you'd asked me for it, I'd like, who's Scarlet? So I would have, had have been digging through the internet to draw this, but, that's very cool. All right. I've got something. Now this is from, you guys will be amazed because this is from, my favorite artist, who of course is me. And, but since it fits with the animation, theme of today. I did this for my daughter. It's hanging in her room. I had to go grab it. But of course, this is Tangled, and with all the guys from the tavern, they're all the kind of what do I want to call them? Barbarian guys that were hanging out in that tavern, and my favorite scene in the movie. So I've done a couple commissions with Rapunzel in them, but I drew this piece, and my daughter goes, "Oh, can I have that?" And I'm like, "Sure." So there it is. Hanging on a wall. That's all with colored pencil and marker.
I'm surprised she didn't demand you draw her looking like Rapunzel.
Yeah, you know, I've done enough drawings of her in sketchbooks and stuff as different characters that I guess
she gave me. I remember one with it during your Christmas dream. You said that she would just walk into a room and be like, "Dad, draw me," and then just strike a pose.
And she'd strike a pose, right? And then I would and draw a bird on my arm, you know, or something. And you know, so yeah, I have a few.
The art director.
Yeah. Few of those in my sketchbooks, you know, she was quite the poser. But anyway, so that's a piece I did for my daughter. And of course, again, let's get a big shot of the booty. Let's just do it because there it is.
So, if you gave her white hair, we could have maybe said it was Tarna. Caveman Tarna. That's, we could have done right. That.
This was going to be in heavy metal, but they changed their mind at the last minute. But anyway, so that's my... my booty pick for the day. all right. So I've got to imagine, James, that you have a con story that somehow ties into all of this.
I do. 2011, Emerald City Comic Con. I didn't get my usual Artist Alley table that year. I got a booth. I went super big. And one of the artists I was working with at the time, Randy Kintz, he was going to be at my booth with me because he was unable to get a table on Artist Alley. And I had him and another artist, Ben Hansen, who I was working with, and I had them do a image that I got colored and made into a print. Now, mm-hmm. This is 2011. Okay. It was the 25th anniversary of Transformers, the movie. So I had them do Rodimus Prime and Galvatron in the poses of Dr. Doom and Iron Man from the cover of Iron Man 150 with a ghostly head of Optimus above Rodimus and a ghostly head of Megatron above Galvatron. And I had a guy color it and I made prints of it and I sold them at the show and I sold a whole buttload of them. And I remember this is I brought this with me and played it all weekend long at the show. If you came by my booth, you were hearing the songs from this right here all weekend long. And every time somebody'd walk by the booth, if they had a Transformer shirt on, I'd have been like, hey, come on, man, you gotta buy this. Otherwise, you gotta give that shirt up, man. You lose all your credit if you don't buy one of these. I can't tell you how many times that worked.
Man, see, you've got to be a barker. You've got to be like a, you know, shameless self-promoter. And I am terrible at that stuff, you know. Randy Emberlin is a guy who's great at selling, you know, at his booth. And I'm terrible at it. I just sit there and, you know, I never bring up anything unless someone starts talking to me, you know. And it's like, I got to.
Yes, that's I celebrated the 25th anniversary of Transformers movie by getting an original print in full color made with two different artists. Randy did the Autobot side. Ben did the Decepticon side. And it was just, you know, basically, if you look at the image, it's all about the movie, like everything in the movie in a single image.
That's cool. And you did it and made money. So that's even cooler. So, okay. I'm getting a little bit of, what was it? Evil One says, I'm not going to participate in inflating Aaron's ego. This is out there. Aaron, did you ever learn to edit on Premiere or did you actually cut film? Dude, I cut film. Wow. We just had like the cool thing was we got these video editors where, you know, video machine editing, and we would have these, you know, not beta, but the, what was the other format for, VHS. So we have like these VHS tapes, but they were like twice as big. They were like half inch. So you'd get better clarity on the video. And so we take these huge tapes, shove them into these big video monitor editing monitors. And so that's how we would edit video tape. But in terms of film, we were on, those old style, editors, Moviolas, where you'd had, this is totally off topic, I realize, but where you'd have your film would be, you know, your AB rolls, whatever, you'd have your one roll that your working print that you were working with, and that would go in one. And then there was a soundtrack that was on magnetic film or tape. And then you would run them and get them synced up. And that's how you'd sync up your visuals with your audio. And then once those things were cut, you'd had those two rolls and they would go down and then to the lab and they'd merge them into one. And then you'd have optical sound print on the film. But yeah, I mean, it was totally old fashioned. In fact, we didn't even get to use, you know, you've seen those flatbed editors, right? That Hollywood would use, where there's this huge table and they'd put the reels in on their side. And then they'd run it through and they'd have multiple screens and they would edit that way. I'm talking about the old Moviolas, you know, where you had a little screen right here and you'd had a pedal down at the bottom and you'd hit the speed and it would run the thing through. And then you'd take your foot off the pedal and the film would stop. And yeah, so it was very, very old school.
Well, we got Zeno the Stoic here who.
Robert Preston. Are we talking about the music?
No, not that one. Another one. It must be further up. We're talking about Weird Al.
Oh, Weird Al doing the song on the junk.
Dare to be stupid. It's like
that's what you were playing.
I guess you were here at the start of the show because if you did, you would have seen that happen on this stream live. So.
That's funny. Let's see here. Aaron is good. Anyway, so I got a couple of saying that I'm shamelessly plugging my own art, and you're absolutely right. That's exactly what I'm doing, and I appreciate you taking notice of the fact that that's actually what I'm doing. But anyway,
when people say call me or you or anybody a shameless self-promoter, I always take it this way. It's like, if you don't care about your stuff, how can you expect other people to?
Exactly. If you don't care about the booty, who else is going to care about the booty? That's what I have to say. Anyway, okay, so I need a con story, right?
Yes.
I went, what was it, San Diego 19... Would have been, it was before I was a professional, so it would have been 88, 89-ish, and Wrightson was on a panel. So I was in there, you know, listening to talk.
This is a story where you tick him off before you're even a professional. Is that what this is?
Maybe. He's up. I kept asking. I was asking like 10 times as many questions as anybody else did, because I was like, you know, I was a total Wrightson honk and knew everything about him that was to know, that was available to know, and all of his art and everything. And so I would ask him. And then I started asking him like business questions and stuff, you know, about contracts and things. It was stuff that was boring people to tears, right? But then I made this. I asked him about a. He had done a poster called Moon Pool, and it was this guy looking in to this pool at night, and his reflection was out of a werewolf. But the guy looked exactly like one of the dudes from The Howling, right?
Yeah.
And so I made some joke about it. I can't remember what the joke was, and got zero laughs from anybody, including Wrightson and the people up on the panel. And then I had to segue and go, but anyway, did you get any royalties or anything for the, you know, and because I specifically referenced Moonpool as being the guy looked like the guy in The Howling, and his werewolves, of course, look like all Wrightson werewolves in that movie. And it was funny. So I made the joke that nobody laughed at. And then so I segued into the thing and said, did you, you know, did you have anything to do with the movie? And he was like, how he put it, he seemed very grumpy about it. Said, you know, sort of sarcastically, but it was, you know, like, you know, not officially, you know, basically saying that they ripped him off and he got nothing for it. And, thank you, young man, for bringing up this sore spot. But later
on, trust you on how to make friends and influence people, folks. Right there. There it is.
And but I did go up to him afterwards, and I had my Frankenstein hardcover and I had him sign it. And I remember saying, you know, it was really awkward, and you know, because the first time I'd ever met him, and I just said, you know, I want to thank you for all the free art lessons you've given me over the years. I'm just a big fan. And he was like, signed his name and next. You know, so
he signed it to Aaron. Thanks for reopening old wounds.
Wounds, exactly. You dick. Signed to Bernie Wrightson. Yeah. So my first meeting with Wrightson wasn't as smooth as I would have wanted.
Geek Avenger, here it is. This is what Bernie told you. Geek Avenger got it right here.
Yeah, why don't you just give me a paper cut and pour lemon juice on it? you know, but that I was, you know, and I still am, I guess, to a certain degree. And some of us do it, you know, more than others, but I'm great at putting my foot in my mouth constantly. You know, but it's like, you don't think about stuff like that. You think, well, all those werewolves looked like Wrightson drew them and designed them. Surely he had something to do with the movie. And then of course you find out he did not have anything to do with the movie. He was not happy about it. Yeah. So, there you go. So I started pissing off people before I even got into the industry. So, and it's been something I've continued to do.
So long for you to make it in. I have no idea why it took so long. It's mystery of the universe, I suppose.
Oh man. And even when I was a pro, I've been out to dinner with him. I'd start asking him about artwork. You know that, okay, you know that skit on Saturday Night Live when William Shatner was guest hosting and he was standing up in front of the crowd, and it was supposed to be at a Star Trek convention, and they were asking him all these questions and stuff. Yeah. And, you know, and one of the guys goes, hey, you know, remember that episode where the girl did this and that and the thing, and you opened up the you know, the thing in your wall, and there was that safe in there, and you opened the safe and there was this thing in there, and he goes, do you remember what the combination of that safe was? You know, and Shatner's like, no, I don't remember. You know, I would do that to Wrightson at dinner. I'd be like, you know, I saw this piece where this guy was doing this and that. Do you remember what that was? And he's like, I have no idea what you're talking about.
It was just a job, kid. It was just a job. It didn't mean anything.
But you see, you'd see these pieces of like half finished rights and art, right? And you're like, wow, I wonder what that was from or what that was for, why he didn't finish it. And then I would ask him those questions and he would be like, yeah. Oh, it was 30 years ago. I don't know.
That was 30 years ago.
So now I'm waiting for people to do that to me, right? It's like, you know, hey, Aaron.
No, what they do to you is like, oh, I really love your work. You're so great. You realize I'm not Adam Hughes, right? Hughes.
Oh, gosh.
Okay. Yeah. Bye.
That's happened to me more than once. How I can be mistaken for Adam Hughes more than once is a story in and of itself, I suppose. But
I love your Wonder Woman covers. you mean my covers or you mean Adam Hughes covers? Wait a minute.
I like yours though too. And you're like,
get out of here. I gotta go.
Yeah, get out of here. Are you kidding me? Get a life. Oh my gosh. All right. Well, I think that's move out of your parents' basement. I don't know if he's talking to me or people in the that's a Shatner line from Guys, get a life. Have you ever kissed a girl? Move out of your parents' basements, you know, experience life. There it is, leg kick saying, Aaron making enemies low presti. That's me. Evil one. Don't say Adam Hughes is over. I don't think I would never say that. I love Adam's stuff, but I've had let's say I said I've told the story before. How many times people come up to me and I love your work, it's so great, you're brilliant, and blah blah blah. And that's when I start to know they think I'm somebody else. And it was usually either Adam or occasionally Terry Dodson because we shared a booth for so many years at San Diego. But it was, I've never had anybody come up to me and say, your stuff is brilliant, I loved it, and haven't actually realized that it was me they were talking to.
You got to see what it is they say about your stuff. You say, well, what stuff do you think is like the most brilliant? And if they say something like, oh, well, your stuff on Justice League and your stuff on, you know, this cover work here, and you're like, oh, that's Adam Hughes. But they say, oh, I love Sludge. Sludge was awesome. See, now you know, okay, they're my fan.
That's right. This person actually knows who I am. They're not mistaking me.
This guy got it right. He knows who I am. Okay. Yeah.
I do. I had a couple of those where, you know, people said some really nice things. And I started to think, here we go. I'm not who they think I am. And then they'd go, but man, that stuff you did on Sludge or whatever. And I'm like, oh, thank God. I don't have to be humiliated again. Oh my gosh. But anyway, so, that's going to be it for the show today, unless I'm forgetting something. Do you have anything else, James, you want to throw out there?
No, we covered everything except, of course, down below, guys, in the description section, we got, you know, Aaron's two campaigns, Blood Hunters and The Second Chance for the original Wraith of God, both live right now, but one of them is not shadow banned. So
that's right. One of them is not.
So you can be sure to see them and go back them if you haven't already. I've already backed Blood Hunters, and I got Wraith of God the first time because I'm not a knucklehead, but hey, for all you knucklehead,
thank you.
Now I have a second chance. Now you have a chance to change your status as a knucklehead. So back it today. Of course, down there for me, you got my art gallery with all the art from the artists that I have. You know, over 1,000 pieces available right now. We got the MeWe group, all the information about what I'm doing and what the artists are doing, all posted up there. And of course, my YouTube channel right here on YouTube, where I do stuff on there. And in fact, if you go there now, you will find that there is the top two playlists are this, the Comic Art Convo. So if you missed any of them, I got them right up there for you on the top. You can go through them and check them all out. And then right underneath is a thing I do with Pops on Pop Culture, who we do a monthly thing called Why Is It Great, where we each take a comic that we read from the past that we love, and we tell you why it's so awesome and that you should have it in your collection. And we just started doing that this year. Our next one coming up here is going to be on the 29th. On Wednesday is the new one, and it's all right down there, so you can check those out. Also, Aaron did an interview with Pops that went live last Wednesday, so you want to go over and check. So like I said, go check out the Why It's Great on my channel, and then head over to Pops and subscribe to his channel, and check out Aaron's interview over there. It's good stuff. So we've both been busy doing lots of stuff, guys, so it's all for you guys just because we care so much and want to provide you guys quality entertainment. You know, the stuff Disney doesn't want to do anymore, we decide we're going to do it.
That's right. We're here for you guys. And we thankfully that you guys are here for us, because we couldn't do the show if we didn't have an audience. We appreciate you guys taking the time to join us and also interact.
Next show, the next Comic Art Convo, April 29th.
Okay.
The opening topic, our favorite comic annual stories, all stories from comic book annuals.
Oh, I've got a couple there.
I figured you would.
I got a couple there. And thankfully, I'm like 10, 12 years older than you, so probably we're not going to overlap.
Not too much, I would assume.
So we're going to hit the 70s and the 80s probably. So I definitely got a few that have stayed with me for a long time. So you guys, thank you for joining us. We really appreciate it. It's always a good time interacting with the chat and giving our rather controversial opinions at times. And please join me tomorrow and Shelly Showtime for Aaron Live at 4 p.m. Pacific. And hopefully Shelly will be joining us. And but I can guarantee you Bigfoot in some capacity will be there. So anyway,
and you guys. Always remember, folks, remember one thing above all else. You got the touch. You got the power.
All right, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you next time. Bye, everybody.